Freaky Table is brought to you by Nikki Hits Beauty Studio, Bona Musadi, Douala, and Jungle Hub, Boya.
Hello guys, my name is Joan Gomba and I'm joined by Yana Junior as well as the Nollywood actor Eyina Nwigwe. I hope I'm pronouncing that name right.
Oh my Eyina God. Nwigwe.
Nwigwe. Nwigwe.
Yes. Okay. That's good.
I'm getting there. So this is Kamif Special and we're hanging out with some of the guests who are coming up for this festival in Boya. And we brought him here not just to show us his fine face, but to tell us the importance of fitness in film, as well as food, right? He eats a lot of food, so he's going to be talking about all the Cameroon food he has eaten so far. So we'll have to pin him on that one. But it's coming special, guys. So let's take a quick break. When we get back, so much more coming up next. Welcome back, guys. It's Joan, Yana, and Eyina in the... Yana, Eyina. Okay, good.
Wow, Joan.
Did we get married?
No.
What happened to... Point.
Where did... Gomba.
You know, Eyina, Yana,
you're
Gomba.
Yeah, Gomba.
Gomba.
Okay, you're Yana?
Yeah.
Oh, I
thought
it was your last name, Joan. Yana.
Oh! Gomba and Eyina still go now.
Gomba, Eyina, it's still Yana. Good. Ah, nice. The na-na-na. So African.
Oh, na-na.
Bars.
Man, we have too many Tupacs in the building. Okay. Yeah. So back in December, Koi Longa, our co-host who is absent today because he's sick, he made a comment when we're discussing Sexiest Man Alive in Cameroon. And he said that one of the reasons why Cameroon film industry lacks rom-coms, which is romantic comedies, is because they lack fit actors who are not sexy. So I don't know whether, let me start with that. So I'll just put you on the spot. Do you think that rom-coms build around fitness and sexiness?
You know, it's hearing this now, it just puts things in perspective somewhat. I am just being introduced to the Cameroon and film space. Yeah. I've met a few leading men. I've seen quite some fit, good-looking men, you know, that can sit as leading men even in Nollywood. Mm-hmm. You know, so I don't know what a person is saying. Is it a case of we don't appreciate our own? We
like maybe
to
they are too
appreciate
few.
Outside, which few. Also happens in Nigeria and everywhere else in the world. Scarcity creates demand, you know, so to speak. What you don't have, you want. Mm-hmm. What you have, you take for granted, you know. Mm-hmm. So they're good-looking men here. It's just he finished us.
That's worrying us.
Yes. So having said that, it also makes sense because at the end of the day, comedy, romance is heightened by spectacle. Mm-hmm. Spectacle, good looks always counts for something, mm-hmm. whether you're in film or beyond film. It's just because you're on TV now and people will get to see you a bit more. That's why they can say, yay. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of good-looking people everywhere, just not in your faces. Mm-hmm. You know. So yes, it makes sense. But I don't agree that there are no good-looking men in Cameroon because I think we have the same features.
No. There are good-looking men, but they are not good-looking actors.
Actors. Okay, I don't know. Are you an actor?
I'm not.
Okay, so because this guy looks like he can be a leading guy. In a rom-com, once he takes his hat off, shades out, the girls be like, woo-woo!
You know, so. Yeah, not that bigger. Like, yeah, your head just grew.
I mean, respect the beard. Beard gang is what the world.
Joe, you know these things. Yeah, just because this is what they call sea finish. Yeah. You understand that? This is sea finish. This is sea finish. No, this is sea finish.
These are the issues.
Yes.
You have seen the finish.
Yeah.
You know what this beard is worth? Outside in America, just one. Let me not say anything.
You see, this is the thing. When I'm the only girl on set, it's very hard.
Don't make it about that.
Hey, okay, please come back.
So, yeah, spectacle is important for film. Mm-hmm. Women like good-looking men. Mm-hmm. Men like good-looking women. And when the two come together, it's magic. And then when the performances also come into all of that, everyone falls in love with screen figures, you know, and they just fall over and just wish and dream and picture themselves with them. And and that is just the effect of TV and film, you know, because you string together human elements, love, you know, romance, of course, you know, whether it's hate, whatever it is, things that we can relate to, all packed in a storyline with two good-looking people. You're drawn to it more than you are with not so good looking people.
Longe did not talk about not good looking men, but fit men.
Fit.
People who are really fit.
I mean, fitness is part of good looks.
Yeah, I mean, no, when
you know, when they pan the camera through like a man's abs and stuff like that, or like he's dripping water.
Yeah, masculinity.
Stuff. It looks very sexy. Yeah. For me, who is a girl, who is looking, you know, and for some gay people, you know, so it looks really sexy.
Yeah.
Which attracts you to TV. Mm-hmm. So his point was that Cameroonian actors are not fit enough.
Yeah.
And that's the reason why they are lack, or the industry lacks romantic comedy movies.
Are you saying they eat too much fufu and eru? Because and I eat and cocky, because I eat those things too.
But how can you resist that?
Yeah?
How can you resist
all of that? I mean, like, it's there. It's really there in your face. It's there in your face. Like, how can you? How can you stop? But which is really good to be my question, because you're someone who takes interest in food and fitness. Yeah. Are you the one to go to the gym at 4 a.m. come back and eat like 5 hamburgers? Yeah. Add fufu on it.
I'll tell you the truth without meaning to mislead anyone. Yeah. I live life on my terms. I do things as they come. I go to the gym as much as I can when I have the time, but being a working actor in an industry like ours, where the structure isn't so favorable, because we're a location industry, so certain things may not pan out as you plan. Yeah. You know, you plan to shoot for 2 weeks, and around the world you have the 12-hour turnaround time. Anything you do every day must be 12 hours so people can rest and recoup and be productive the next day. Mm-hmm. Or in our own time, you're using someone's house, you're trying to use that street, the day is free, you know, you can't control sound, things just fall all around, but you have to be constantly the soldier as an actor, you know, in the midst of all of that chaos. Mm-hmm. So even if it takes you having to commit to a project for 48 hours because they might lose the location if they don't shoot in those 2 days, then you do that, you know. So usually when I'm busy with work, especially in leading man capacity, you're in almost every scene, so you're always on standby. So I am not able to go to the gym, and if that continues for months, I'm off the gym. So it's a struggle to tie the gym into that routine. Mm-hmm. But every time I get a chance, I go hard, so hard that I at least get myself fit enough that when I'm off, I can still be fit for a while until I come back. Mm-hmm. So I found that rhythm now. I used to be a lot more regular than I am now, because work is important.
Mm,
you know, I mean, you have this problem with empty pockets. You know,
you have a flat pocket.
Yeah, with one pack pocket. So, you know, so, but then food is passion for me.
Okay.
You know, I can also do all day without eating, which is a very terrible thing, because I've gotten so used to eating in the comfort of my space. Mm-hmm. Because I love to cook as well. I'm a local food guy, especially. Yeah. You know, if I wake up at 1 a.m. or if I'm up at 1 a.m. and I crave a goosey and poundo, and I have it in the fridge or the ingredients, I'll go into the kitchen and make it and eat it.
At 1 a.m. So,
I don't stop myself.
But
guess what? I know there are rules, because my routine is now different. Mm-hmm. I could have worked till 12, and that's, don't forget that, and I'm active, I'm climbing stairs, because this is my office, this is my work.
Yeah.
I'm always in motion, I'm not sitting behind a desk. Mm-hmm. So what applies to the guy behind the desk and sits in traffic all day from AC to AC is different, and it's hard work, from my hard work that requires me to always be physically applying myself. If I have to run the steps for 5 takes, I'm doing that. If I have to run on the stretch of a road for a scene, I'll do that. But you won't call that workout. You call that work. Mm-hmm. But then you're still burning. Mm-hmm. You get what I mean? I could stay all day not eating, because I will not enjoy the meal if I'm not relaxed enough to have like an hour after to just chill and get back. So I cannot eat on the go while everyone is eating. I eat on my time, not on anybody's time. Mm-hmm. So this makes up for, even if it's 10 burgers at night, my calorie quota has been open all day.
Mm-hmm.
So I can fill it up with that.
Yeah.
And it's what I crave. Mm-hmm. You know, so somehow it fits and works.
It works for you.
Yeah. Well, and men metabolize better anyway. So
it works for you. But that's good. I mean, I check out your Instagram sometimes when you post your fitness videos and your sessions at the gym. And I'm like, damn, man, I cannot do that one. And then the things like, so what is so, when you enter the gym, what exactly are you looking for? What are you fitting? What are you looking for?
Because I used to really play tennis intensely, I kind of like got myself injured in the knees.
Okay.
So I kind of like manage the things I do. I won't go so hard on the treadmill like I used to. Usually I just go in for the first 1 hour and do power walk on the treadmill. Why I do that is because chances are that, okay, I might get pulled out of the gym for something, or my morale could drop for workout, but then I know that I have burnt at least 600 calories on the treadmill while doing, you know, handling emails, doing stuff.
Well, your fingers are working.
Yes, you know, while training my fingers too, working out the fingers, while maybe watching a movie on my phone that I need to complete or reading a script, so I can still work out and be productive. Mm-hmm. Because when it comes to weight, you need your hands and everything else. So that is usually the only thing I'll call routine. But once I'm done with that, anything else is a free game for me. I just go where my body leads me. I also try to get in some you know, knee muscle area, you know, strengthening because of the knee situation I have now from tennis. You know, so it goes that way. I follow my heart and how my body feels when I'm in the gym.
Well, you don't have like a trainer at the gym to help you out?
I never had one. I think I've been considering one for over a year now. And every time I go, I just go because I just feel like this trainer should want to do what they think, not how your body feels.
Yeah.
You know, so I just go. I do it myself.
I mean, okay, but also talking about food and you know, and what you can eat and what you cannot eat. Do you compensate not going to the gym sometimes with dieting? Like, okay, you're gonna go just strictly on vegetables, or you abstain from certain carbs or something. Do you have that sort of routine? Or,
no.
Oh, okay, yeah.
No, but the first time I tried it for the first time 2 months ago before I got back in the gym this season, which of course in the past 3 or 4 weeks I've been out again because of work, and that was to do detox. Mm-hmm. Was some fruit juice company in Nigeria that does a 3 day, 4 day, 5 day, depending on what the package, use the different juices for you, and that's all you have every day for those number of days. So I was able to pull off a 3 day one, which is the first time ever I tried that.
You
know, I don't know I was expecting. They said your skin will glow, you will do this, you do that. But for me, it was more of a mental thing. Oh, if okay. I could achieve that, it shifted my mind to know that I could stay the course of staying without food for 3 days.
Now, you know, what are some of those mistakes that people make at the gym, especially guys, or perhaps actors? Let's stick with actors.
A mistake people make at the gym, I'll tell you one, and it happens so often. You come to the gym, you see a group of guys, you know, doing squats, doing weights, a girl there goes and joins them, and then you just look and you think because you're a guy and you saw that girl carrying it. That girl has been doing that for years. You just go, the other thing you hear is prap. You see that they will tell like this. And you will just observe, if you observe, because I'm a people watcher. So when I'm in the gym, I have my ears blocked, but I'm watching, I can see the guy that are trying to impress the girls. Yeah. And they now go overdo and hurt themselves. And you're like, okay. And you see the embarrassment, you know. Oh, so follow your own body. If you don't, if you can afford it, get a trainer so that they can take you step by step, you know. So some people don't look the part, but they have inner strength. Yeah. And they've been training. And because you don't see muscles, you think because they could carry that, you can carry it. It doesn't follow. It's like me, no matter how hard I work, yoga, I'm a mess. Yoga, you still have to respect the timing and grow at it.
Yeah.
No matter how fit you are. Mm-hmm. You know, so it's stuff like that. So guys should do things on their own pace.
I'm talking about guys in the gym going to impress and all of that. It's interesting because as an actor, it's almost like you live for the impression, right? And like it brings me to a question about how do actors navigate certain roles where they have to maybe keep fit or just maybe grow overweight to represent that character. What's been the most challenging role physically in terms of fitness and delivering on that?
I have done so many intense movies that sometimes when I think, well, I'm like, how did I survive this? You know, but I, like I said, I'm a soldier. I love adventure. I go at it. The last film I had in the cinemas, I just left the cinemas in Nigeria. It's probably going to come on Netflix soon. It's called Eagle Wings. It's an Air Force story. We literally were going through military drills on set. Not even that we had weeks of training, because we were using the fighter jets that they used to defend the nation, using the fighter helicopters, using some of the personnel and the guns. And it's only the few minutes we have to use them that we have to use them, and the Air Force will not let it fly if it's not spot on how it is. So we had to be quick on my feet to pick up everything, both using their CAK 430 guns, the Tavor. These are their most sophisticated weapons, using it in real time, being in a set of the art fighter jet, like you are actually a pilot trained for it, like you can own it and look the part, literally, in those moments, you know, flying over real danger zones, Boko Haram zones, you know, and capturing shots from real missions, really, yeah, you know, and all these things are so intense. The terrain where you are, if you have to climb rocks and valley, come down valleys to get there, you do that, you know, and you're doing it with some of the trained personnel, but I am not trained like that. I'm an actor, so I have only my mind to make me feel like I am them. Yeah. But then my body, if it weren't tough enough or trained in terms of my workout and fitness, then I will have a different outcome. Some of the few other actors that were just actors on the project, you could tell the difference in how they felt and how beat they were every session. But for me, physicality, my mindset, you know, I carried it differently. And as tough as it was still fun and another feather added to the experiences, you know, one has had, you know, and there are quite a number of them like that. There are quite a number of them, you know. Black November was intense in its own way as well. There's a film called Love Struck that I had to do a certain kind of run, and that was at the point where my knees were really bad and really sore. But I had to run, you know, like so intensely. A camera is at the back of a car moving, and to capture that, you have to chase the camera. And the distance and the number of takes on hard surface, cold tar, that was intense. And it was just one scene. It wasn't like the whole film was intense, but that one scene messed me up. Last year, November, I was on a set as well. It's more like a period piece. You know, that was probably my first epic. It's yet to come out, Igbinogu. There was a flashback scene that was probably about, that's probably going to be about 10 seconds in the film, but it took over 2 hours to shoot. And it was stunts, you know, fighting a war with knives, jumping on trees, landing, getting on a horse, jumping off a horse, landing on broken bottles with bare feet, burning tires, just to create the picture, you know, that was right. And I had to do all those things. You know,
wow, man, if you're not fit, you'll not be a joke.
So, and we don't have the capacity for body doubles in the industry like Hollywood does. So, you find yourself doing these things. And
have you ever been injured on set? Have you ever been injured on set?
Yeah,
wow,
yeah, I've been injured several times. Yeah, if you look at this pinky finger, it is bent. It's been a year and it's not healed yet.
Man, Asha, I'm sorry. Bele. Bele, so you have Blockbuster. Wedding Party was amazing. And I think the whole of the world has watched that movie by now. And they had Hire a Man. I think you were in Hire. Those are the rom-coms that I'm talking about. Mm-hmm, like mm-hmm. I watched. But in Wedding Party, there was a misunderstood proposal with your girlfriend or the white lady who was there, the character. And I think there was a ring somewhere which she picked, and then at some point she had to say yes, even though he did not propose. Mm-hmm. It was just all mixed up and stuff. How crazy do scenes like that get you? Like in your real life, how do you think proposals are supposed to be made? Because recently, public proposals seem to be like the worst idea.
Mm.
Girls reject proposals now, like publicly.
Mm.
But you had to accept a proposal in the movie even though it was not it.
Yeah.
So how do you regard proposals? Should it go public or private?
I think it depends on the people involved. Mm. A guy should be sensitive to the kind of woman that he's about to propose to. Should know her enough to know if it will excite her or embarrass her. Mm. And likewise, the girl should know what will excite or embarrass the man. So some people like the show. Some people want to share their love with the world. Some people be like, you know what? I don't want all of this evil. Because once you open it to them, they start to pick holes or, you know, sow seeds in your head. So it all depends. You know, I'm not a showy person. I like my private life private. The only thing that is public about me is my work.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I keep it that way. Mm-hmm. You know, so like I said, it depends on the person.
All right, so there's
another. Find a guy that's private and a girl that wants the show. And it's a conflict, you know, so...
Yeah, so how does that work?
But a girl doesn't know you're going to propose, so she won't set it up.
True.
Yeah.
True. All right, so there's another question that's been going on, trending on social media. Once you propose to somebody, and the person, public or private, and the person says no, what happens to that relationship next? Does it continue or does it stop from that moment?
I wouldn't know what happens to them.
I'm just saying, just imagine. That, okay, perhaps you had a character that had to do that. Like, what would happen? Do you still continue chasing that wife to be? Or
yeah, some people love that. Some people love like that. Some people love fully and foolishly. And yeah, because I don't see why you'd be chasing after something that doesn't want someone that doesn't want you. That's your chasing to commit yourself to being that chaser for the rest of your life, and knowing that the person doesn't feel the same way. Even if the person out of say, oh, it's time to get married, a girl's looking at her age and like, I don't like this guy, but he seems to be serious about me. So okay, what kind of marriage would that be?
I'm not married, so I don't know.
But you are asking me questions, you know, so you know, so
but it was a very serious question on Twitter. I think you know, I saw lots of Nigerian celebrities.
I don't know. Some people who can hide behind the fact that I didn't see it coming. That was just a reaction that came through after thinking about it. I feel differently, but I was embarrassed. I didn't know how to react in a situation like that. It could be that.
But should the relationship continue or stop right there? That's the question.
I think
after a proposal gone wrong, or say they say no, I don't want to be your wife. What happens to that relationship after that?
See, that's what I'm saying. Some people are fighters. Some people only know how to continue trying to convince someone. While some people are like, you know what?
We're done.
Yeah, but for me, I find it tacky that anybody would make a proposal and not know that the chances will be a no. How can you propose to someone and you're not sure? It doesn't add up. There's a lack of self.
There's something wrong somewhere.
Lack of sense of self there. And a lot of people are incomplete in that sense. A lot of people are insecure. A lot of people are, I don't know. There's something off about proposing without sensing the fact that she's not ready for you in that way. You should know.
And yet it's supposed to be a surprise.
Yeah, I don't know, but you should know where the relationship is. And know, most times people that propose publicly and the girl accepts have already talked about their family plans. Oh, how many kids would you like to have? So you already know that you're looking at a family future, a future with this person as a family. You know, then the question is, what if something goes wrong tomorrow and he doesn't propose or she doesn't accept? You know, that is when it's a case of, I can't wait for him. That's the only anxiety that the woman has now.
Yeah.
Not that she doesn't know that she wants to be with this guy and this guy wants to be with her, because they have discussed things that have shown that they are moving forward together, you know, and not feeling funny signs in between. And then you decide to throw a proposal in the wheel of that, you know. So I think a lot of people don't really understand what it takes to really get to that point, or get married, or cross over into marriage. You just think it's time, and you find attraction, or you think this is the woman. If she's not in sync with it, what kind of marriage would that be?
Hey, I mean, we've talked about a lot of things, about fitness, relationships, movies, and everything. Okay, now there's this very popular series, TMC, The Men's Club. You have a lot of fit guys there.
Mm.
Every lady I know watches that series talks about how hot the guys are.
Mm.
Now, do you think, in the way, as somebody who's really involved in the movie industry from behind the scenes to actually being on screen, do you think that also interests how directors and script writers, you know, channel, decide to, you know, to write scripts? Do you think that interests them because they want to serve what the public want?
Yeah. She just said it. Yeah, sex sells. Yeah. You give people what they're yearning for. Mm-hmm. If people love visuals, that's the same way the internet and the social media is influencing people's lives.
Yeah.
You know. You see people, you know, all made up. You think that's the real person until they jump in the pool. Yeah. You go to the pool with them one day, you realize that's not them. It's all smokes and mirrors, you know. So it's what it is. I, there a lot of times you meet a girl today, tomorrow you meet her, she thinks you're snubbing her. You just didn't recognize the same person you saw.
Amen.
Makeup week. Yeah. It takes these days, it takes longer interaction with a female for her to register, and you know her personality and her look.
Mm-hmm.
Because once she throws on a wig, It's a different person.
Why? So why are you looking at my wig? Talk there. Like,
am I wearing a wig?
You're the only
I
one here.
Oh,
I thought it was your natural hair. So this is wig.
You still here?
You cast yourself.
Yeah. But you also now just to keep it directors and writers. Now that's their part. But you think that also influences actors? You know, you find a very frail guy, but he's seen that, okay, these guys are taking leading roles, and he also wants to advance his career. He's like, man, if I get six packs right now, I could get a leading role.
Yeah.
Do you think that plays on them? And how challenging is it as an actor who maybe is always behind the scenes, doesn't really get top roles, and you find that is a trend, but then you may not be so good looking, but then you compensate with the fitness. How much do you think that's a challenge mentally, and also for them, you know, keeping up with the profession?
Yeah, while we're keeping this within the acting conversation, it's also a problem in the world generally with people.
Yeah.
Keeping up with the Joneses, grass is greener on the other side. Yeah. Oh, I wish I had his body. I wish I had his hair. Every human being wants what they don't have.
Yeah.
Even the best looking people are most times the most insecure.
I mean, look at the Kardashians. After having surgery, yeah. She had to move.
Most of the most beautiful people are the most insecure when you look at it, because at the end of the day, it's a mindset that happened, that it boils down to, which is a huge conversation I've been spinning, through the classes here. Mindset is like where everything starts from. Mm-hmm. Are you enough or not? If you're not enough, how much can you be being like this guy, that guy? Because once you start that, there will always be a guy. Yeah. It's a different thing. Like the time I was my fittest, when I was doing Black November, I was in LA. LA is a vanity city, naturally. If you're not working, you're in the gym.
Yeah.
You know, everyone is trying to look good. You know, I got to my fittest. How did I do that? I used like a vision board of some sort. I found an internet a picture on the internet of a guy coming out of a beach. His t-shirt was wet and you could see his packs. Mm-hmm. I put that as my wallpaper. So every time I pick up my phone to do anything, I remember I have to hit the gym. I remember I have to eat right. I remember I have to prepare myself. And in 3 months, I got that body.
Okay.
You know, it's still one of my most iconic shirtless pictures. Today.
I want to know the Cameroonian food you've eaten so far. I mean, for 5 days now, or 6 days you've been in Cameroon?
Yeah. I've tried ndole.
Ndole, okay.
I've tried...
Dole and what?
Yeah, with plantain.
Okay.
Right. I've had eru. Eru is afang. We have it in Nigeria.
Yeah.
Ndole is bitter leaf and peanut, but then we do bitter leaf as a different meal. This is afang, but just not pounded.
Pounded, like, exactly.
Yeah, so it's like okazi in the Igbo culture.
Yeah,
but cooked true. Like afang.
Yeah.
And the thickness. And the oil, which is amazing. In fact, I had some an hour ago. I've had that three times.
Eru,
it's what has been presented to me.
Okay,
because I'm not going out of this premises to eat. But then Eru, I mean, Dole is so good.
Oh yeah.
Like I can't take it away. I can't even compare them because Eru is closer to what I'm used to. Dole is a discovery for me.
Anyway, I'm saying so because there's this ongoing war, never ending war internally between Dole and Eru.
In all honesty, yeah. I would be inclined to Ndole. I'll be more inclined there because it's different. It's new, and then you know when you eat something for the first time and you really appreciate it, that means it's so good.
Yeah.
If not, it should be an acquired taste that grows on you. Mm-hmm. You know. Then I've tried the kwakuku. Then I tried the ogbono egusi mix.
Yeah.
Yeah. I've never seen that combination in Nigeria.
I mean, basically, that's really Cameroon for you.
Yeah.
We have over 200. Yeah.
Yeah.
You could literally go on a 30-day.
Food course.
Food
right?
course, yeah, where you never get any food in Cameroon. So that's how
I'm getting into the food content space. So hopefully, one of the travel shows I'll bring here as well and just experience and compare dishes, you know, and see and show the world because this is tourism.
Yeah.
You know, food is major tourism. Ethiopia is on the world map because of your food. You have Ethiopian restaurants everywhere in the world. Why not Cameroon? Why not Nigeria? Jollof has brought a bit of light to the West African region because of the wars, jollof wars.
Yeah,
so it'd be nice to explore a bit more of those things.
Have you eaten Cameroonian jollof?
No, I haven't. I've been asking. Everybody's so busy that they no one to tend to those small things.
the thing is, Cameroon jollof is Cameroon jollof rice is not something which we present for occasions like that. It's mostly for kids' parties and.
Okay,
you know,
I would like to try the jollof particularly.
Yeah. No, I wish we had done that because we'd have asked that question right now, like Nigerian jollof.
It's obvious now.
So it's a whole Ghana, Nigeria kind of.
You've entered the battleground.
Fully armed.
Well, the other people are still fighting. You're just coming to the war now.
The one last question we're going to ask, and perhaps that's coming from social media, is would Eyinna love to be called or be declared the sexiest man alive in Nigeria?
Would I like to be?
Yeah.
What a vain question to answer. I'd like to be the sexiest man alive in Nigeria.
Or I'm already the sexiest man alive.
Don't I look the part already?
You know.
So those are from fans anyway.
Well, the fans give those awards, not me.
Okay.
They decide. Yeah, they decide. I've gotten some of those titles before, you know, but it wasn't my making, you know. So if they feel that way, then blessings to God. Because at the end of the day, it's the person that you see that you can quantify. It's not because there aren't sexier people out behind you, but because of what you do, how they admire you. So sexiness now has gone beyond just the body. Yeah, so I think there's a lot more that comes to that to give that effect or that feeling across for a group of people to agree collectively and say, yeah, that's a guy. So if they say that, thank you. Can I take my shirt off now?
All right, so that was it for the discussion on fitness, film, and food with the Nigerian superstar, Eyinna Lyonga Nwigwe. Okay. Mola Lyonga. Okay, you can find him on social. He's not going to change his name to Lyonga anywhere on Instagram, but you can find Eyinna on Instagram, on Twitter, and perhaps Facebook.
Yeah.
Great. So if you have more questions for him on fitness, regime, all those things, please, you can ask. But you can also drop your comments down at the YouTube channel, and he's going to be there perhaps, and all of us, to answer you. So thank you guys so much for watching, Eyinna. Thank you so much for stopping by.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, nice. Always good to see you. Guys, stay out of trouble and remember to love God more. See you soon.
Freaky Table is brought to you by Nikki Hits Beauty Studio, Bona Musadi, Douala, and Jungle Hop, Boya.
Jungle Studios, which is located at Solidarity Junction, Boya, for all your photography and videography.
Thanks for watching the dopest TV show right now.
And don't forget to subscribe so that you can continue seeing our beautiful faces. Scratch that, my handsome face.
Alright guys, and to never miss a thing, follow us on all social media platforms at Freaky Table, Instagram, Facebook, and yeah, stay tuned.